Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this streamed worship service from Christ Congregational Church in Brockton, Massachusetts. I'm Barry Shelley, our moderator. We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ. We are very glad you're joining us today, and we welcome you no matter who you are and where you are on life's journey. If you are a visitor and want to learn more about us, please explore our website at brocktoncc.org. And if you'd like to know more and or talk with one of our pastors, please call the church office during the week. You can also sign up on our website for our regular nearly weekly email postings that provide up-to-date information about things going on in our congregation. You can sign up under subscribe to CCC's e-news. And I encourage everyone to take a look at those nearly weekly postings. In particular, this week, you'll find helpful information about our plans for Lent. Those include the following. First, our worship will be informed by the book, Pray Like Jesus, Rediscovering the Lord's Prayer. Each week, worship will focus on one specific part of the Lord's Prayer. Second, each Friday at 12:30 p.m. on Facebook Live, Pastor Jeff will offer experiences in engaging with different prayer practices, such as guided meditation, Lectio Divina, and more. More details about these and other Lenten offerings can be found on those email postings. Finally, today at 11, going to 12:30, that is soon after this worship service concludes, we'll kick off our Lenten series of Breakfast and Beliefs, also via Zoom. The theme of this first session is Signs of Hope, a program that originally was planned for Advent and had to be postponed. Our leadoff speakers, Bob Cutting, Leanne Larson, and David Wilcox, will offer brief reflections on the topic, and then we'll open the discussion to everyone. Let me remind you that we will not have a regular virtual fellowship hour this week so that everyone can join this program. Please note also that the second session of Breakfast and Beliefs will not be next Sunday. It will be this coming Saturday at 9 a.m. In that second session, we will explore how and why we worship. You can find a schedule and further information about the six-week program at the link provided in nearly weekly communications. But back to today. After the benediction, stand up, stretch, grab another cup of coffee and a bite of brunch. Then before 11, sit back down at your computer or other device. Click on the Zoom link provided in yesterday's nearly weekly posting and join us for another Breakfast and Belief series. I hope to see you there. That's all the announcements for this morning. Let us prepare for worship.
Friends, as we enter this time of worship, let us join together in the responsive call to worship. God knows us and our hungers.
God loves us like a father and nurtures us like a mother.
God draws us to each other and claims us as the people of God.
Knowing this, let us worship God.
Let us pray. We come before you, O God, and wait for the kindling flame of your Holy Spirit, calling us into fuller and richer lives. You have blessed us by the night's rest and by morning's light. Open us to your claim on us. Show us your way. Let us live in the spirit of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Oh, if you leave.
Everybody, it's a time for all ages, and today I wanted to talk a little bit about prayer. So now, if you've been here in church, you might have seen people praying in one particular way. A lot of times when we pray in church, we are sitting or sometimes standing, we put our hands together like this, or we bend our head like this and close our eyes. And that can be a really good way to pray. But it's not the only way. And something I've learned is that sometimes it's really hard for me to sit still and pray. I'm trying to sit and focus and close my eyes and do my hands and like this, and I start kind of fidgeting or I get really distracted. And maybe that's you sometimes too. But the great thing is this: there's lots of different ways to pray. You can pray when you're sitting or standing or when you're holding still, or even when you're dancing, because, you know, it was God who put the oogie in our boogie, right? There's lots of different ways to pray. So I want to invite you to join me in a special prayer today, if you'd like. So now, this might be one that's helpful to stand up for, because we're going to move around a little bit, okay? But if you can't stand up, it's okay to do this in a chair, too. But you want to make sure you have some good room around you so that you don't accidentally pray into somebody else. All right. Let's give it a try. Loving Creator God, I reach up high, I bend down low, I hug the ones I love. morning, family. Good morning, God. Good morning, world. Amen. I'm so glad we got to say this prayer together, friends. It was created by a minister named Tracy Smith. And you can use that if you want to pray sometimes while you're moving around, or if you want to make up your own one while you're moving around too, that's awesome. So until I see you next time, have a wonderful week. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Friends, we come to the time of confession in our worship, where we join in confessing the ways we have come up short for God's glory. Not to remind ourselves of how bad we are, but to remind ourselves of how good God is and how eternal God's grace is. So you join me now in the collective prayer of confession found in your bulletin. Almighty God, too often we forget your promise. We live in ways that bring glory only to ourselves. We bask in the false assumption that we are in control of our lives. Sometimes we want to tamper with the lives of those around us for our own ends. Help us to love our neighbors as ourselves and to serve you more faithfully each day. Amen. Friends, in spite of our tendency to pull apart, in spite of our tendency for our old ways, our loving God continues to call us back together again, showing us the true nature of forgiveness. God does not keep score of our wrongs or measure how far we have wandered. God welcomes us, like a mother scooping up her lost children, like a father embracing his prodigal offspring. As we are welcomed home, we are encouraged to learn from that forgiveness. So offer it to ourselves and to others again and again, as God offers it to us in Jesus Christ, our hope and our home. Amen.
Our first scripture reading today comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 8 through 13. My plans aren't your plans, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. Just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my plans than your plans. Just as the rain and the snow come down from the sky and don't return there without watering the earth, making it conceive and yield plants, and providing seed to the sower and food to the eater, so is my word that comes from my mouth. It does not return to me empty. Instead, it does what I want and accomplishes what I intend. Yes, you will go out with celebration and you will be brought back in peace. Even the mountains and the hills will burst into song before you. All the trees of the field will clap their hands. In place of the thorn, the cypress will grow. In place of the nettle, the myrtle will grow. This will attest to the Lord's stature, an enduring reminder that won't be removed. The word of God for the people of God.
Our gospel reading for this morning comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 5 through 13. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you're praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they'll be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, let us pray together. Almighty God, as we come together as your congregation to discern your word for us today, help us to hear you speaking to us in real time. Move us in our hearts to know where you would lead us. And God, as we discern your word together, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Sometimes in life, it feels like words can just escape you. In my own life, there are weeks where it feels like there are no words to preach. Or the words of the liturgy for worship just won't come. Or when I'm asked to pray at a committee meeting or other gathering, I draw a blank. I don't know what to say. Sometimes, in a regular everyday example, sometimes my wife Dani will say something to me and I don't have the words to respond. Sometimes words can escape you. And yet it seems that happens in the moment when you need words the most. This is one of the reasons we love the Lord's Prayer. And it's one of the reasons the Lord's Prayer is a central part of our worship together across Christian traditions, no matter if you're United Church of Christ, Lutheran, Presbyterian, Charismatic, Evangelical. The Lord's Prayer is a central part of our worship together. With the Lord's Prayer, the words never seem to escape us or fail us. Except for the one time while I was leading worship early on and I blanked at, "Give us this day our daily bread." The Lord's Prayer is a prayer we can all come together around. It's scriptural. We can count on it. And choosing a worship series based on the Lord's Prayer for the season of Lent, I wanted to uplift those qualities of the Lord's Prayer. I wanted us to be able to hold together around one simple prayer practice through this difficult season, but I also wanted us to be challenged by it on our Lenten journey. In Bible study this week, as we talked about our scripture readings for today and about the Lord's Prayer in general, our conversation came around to the fact that most of us in that group had never really slowed down to break the Lord's Prayer into its component parts, just stopping after each section and taking 2 or 3 seconds to think about what you just said. I mean, sure, we can all say it in our sleep, but we wondered aloud together at Bible study about whether we had ever really stopped to think about what we're saying with each part of that prayer. Through these next weeks, we'll do just that. And my hope is that the experience will help to lead you to a deeper relationship with the prayer as you pray it. Each week, we'll hear the Lord's Prayer from Matthew, which is our gospel reading for today, along with a second scripture reading that's meant to highlight what's being said in that portion of the Lord's Prayer. Now, a little bit of background. The Lord's Prayer itself can be found in two of the Gospels, Matthew and Luke. And each has a slightly different quality scripturally. Matthew's version, which is what we'll be following for this series, it's longer. It was written to a Jewish Christian audience, and it seems to have added the line, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," while Luke's version lacks that. Both versions have been said to be a good summary of the entire gospel, put together as a set of petitions meant to be heard by God from God's children. The other distinct difference between the two is that the version we're following from Matthew is a part of the Sermon on the Mount, while Luke's version comes in response to one of Jesus' disciples asking him how they should pray. Now, this last distinction, it's important. It's important because the verses that precede the prayer in our text from Matthew give us a hint as to where we should begin when we pray, even before we pray. Jesus says in verses 5 through 8, "And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners so that they may be seen by others. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you're praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words." In other words, don't pray to be fancy or to be seen as a pious person. See, the thing is, God doesn't see one person's prayers as more favorable than another person's prayers. And so on the same token, no one should ever be talked into the idea that they can't pray. Prayer is for us all. Prayer, in the end, is about humbly seeking the presence of the God of all of creation and sharing in your life with that God. And that, friends, well, that's where we start. In both Matthew and Luke, the prayer that Jesus teaches begins with the power, the holiness, and the majesty of God's name. Before we even begin asking for anything, we need to begin by acknowledging God's greatness, God's faithfulness. Once, when I was in seminary, a pastor I worked with challenged me to think about what it means to fear God. And to that point in my life, I hadn't wanted to embrace this idea that we as God's children should fear God. I thought that idea created distance from God. I thought that fear of God led to harmful dogmas and doctrines that enforced right religion over right relationship. But the more I've wrestled with this idea over the years, the more I've come to see that fear of God, well, that can also be described as awe or respect for all that God is. Isaiah's words remind me of this fearful awesomeness that we're speaking to as we begin the Lord's Prayer. God says through the prophet, "My plans aren't your plans, nor your ways my ways. Just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my plans than your plans." God goes on in that passage to talk about how the snow and the rain fall to the earth and they don't return until they've served their purpose, bringing forth fruit and food from the earth. Well, the same goes for God's word and God's will. In the words of the prophet, God's word accomplishes what God intends it to. Indeed, God goes on to say that God's people will go out with celebration and be brought back in peace. That even the inanimate parts of creation, the mountains and the trees and the rocks, they will rejoice and cheer. All of this, according to the prophet, will attest to the Lord's stature as an enduring reminder that won't be removed. In other words, God's will is for God's peace to be realized by all people. And that has been and will be throughout eternity. Now, I don't know about you, but in a lot of ways, that's humbling. And that humbling thought actually frees me up from so much responsibility that I've heaped upon myself unnecessarily. That same pastor who challenged me to think about fearing God, well, he once told me just before I started leading a class about how we can be theologically inclusive of LGBTQ+ people, He told me to be mindful of the fact that if anyone's heart could be changed, it wouldn't be me who was doing the changing. That's God's work, he would say. It's true that we're created in God's image, and that means we're capable of incredible things, especially together. But we're also God's creations. We ourselves are not God. If we stop to think about this part of the Lord's Prayer, the very beginning of it, we'll be reminded that it is we who are invited into God's work and not the other way around. Before anything else can happen in pursuing God's justice or building God's kingdom, our roles in the dynamics of our relationship with God have to be clear. Just as it is with any relationship, respect for who we are and what we bring to that relationship, and respect for who we are in relationship with and what they bring to the relationship, well, these are the foundation for everything that happens. Friends, we're on the Lenten road, moving steadily and slowly toward Jerusalem. In this season, we're called to reflect upon each step of that journey, to feel each footfall and to notice each landmark along the way. We know where the journey leads us. Just as we know God is in control. And that frees us up. That frees us up to attend to what we are experiencing. The Lenten road leads to Jerusalem, through crucifixion, and on to resurrection. In that order, God's will bends the arc of creation toward justice, and that is the journey of our lives. We're going to need things along the way. And God knows that. Indeed, God knows that long before we're even aware of what we need. When we pray, we're simply turning to the one who created us, the one who's laid out this journey for us, and we share the experiences of our lives so that we don't have to be alone on that journey. The good news of the gospel is simply this. God has loved us. God does love us. And God will always love us. The good news of the gospel is that this God, the God who created everything, doesn't just love us. The God of all creation wants us and wants to be in relationship with us, to walk with us and to be with us. The beauty of the Lord's Prayer is that it not only gives us words to pray when words may fail us, but at its simplest, it gives us a place to start by recognizing this good news and reminding us that it will never, ever, ever be otherwise. Amen.
Thank you.
We come to the time in our service where we join together in prayer to lift up our needs individually and our needs as a community. We'd like to lift up especially those on our prayer list this week, those who are in need of a little bit extra prayer, those who are hurting or who are sick, those who are grieving, and those who are serving in the armed forces here and throughout the world. Friends, let us be in a spirit of prayer together. O God of love, we are wayfarers in the world, prone to erratic changes of course, to losing sight of our goals, to becoming so discouraged by the journey that we will hitch a ride on anything that comes along. Help us on our way, O God. If we change our course, let it be not in self-interest, but in order to share the love of Christ with another sojourner. If we lose sight of our goals, let our quest bring us as your curious people to honest searching of our faith. If we become weary and discouraged and forget you are with us, let it lead to recognition of our need for you. As we travel in a world that sometimes seems a trackless, hostile wilderness, we ask that your Spirit sustain, encourage, and enable us to go on. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who walked before us, as we say, Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God, in whom is heaven. The hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. And the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and rest, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Ooh.
Giving is one that Christians have practiced in Lent throughout the ages. As we gather together as a community to offer back what God has given us, may our hearts be drawn towards the journey of Lent. Let us pray. O God, we are made glad by the good news of your love for us and for all. We thank you for creating us and giving us all that is necessary for life. We thank you for your action in Christ by which our lives are measured, found wanting, and renewed. Help us to remember your gifts that we may praise you with lives of joy and service. Through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, friends, go forth into the world and serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And as you go from our worship today, may God be in your going, may Christ be in your doing, and may the Spirit be in your learning. Go in love and peace. Amen.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.